Hello everybody and welcome to this tutorial. Today I'm going to go over a tool called Hydra. It will enable you to actually attack websites but login form, which actually have login forms. Most of them do have login forms. That's pretty much on all the websites today. You can log in somewhere at some portion of the site or something of a kind. Anyway, it is important to mention that this attack functions regardless whether the protocol is HTTPS or HTTP, because I am going to be using a damn vulnerable app. I'm going to be using HTTP, but it's going to work just fine on HTTPS, no problems. So regardless of the encryption, it's going to work. Don't worry about it. Anyway, what does Hydra do for us? How does it help us? Well, it simply enables us to try multiple login credentials over a period of time. So we can try out, I don't know, 20,000 usernames with 20,000 passwords and so on and so forth. You get the general idea of this. Anyway, let me just go ahead and minimize this. Type in Hydra, and I'm going to get a mini here for Hydra. Not a lot of things here. It might seem like a lot, but believe me, it is not. So you have the note from the author of Hydra. This is a bit of an interesting segment here. It says, please do not use in military or secret service organizations or for illegal purposes. And down below you have the syntax. And I know that the syntax, when you look at it like this, it can seem somewhat strange or difficult to comprehend, but believe me, it is not. It is rather simple, of that you can rest assured. All of these brackets and stuff like that can seem a bit complex, but we're going to go over those things, and by the end of this tutorial you will figure out most of these things. They're not complicated as they might seem in the syntax part. Down below you immediately see that the amount of options that Hydra has are not substantial. I mean, there's just a few of them here, not that many, so it's not that difficult. You have basically the ability to pass in with a lowercase l to pass in a single login username, or with a capital L to pass a file leading to a dictionary of usernames. You might wonder like how to create these word lists, but you can find some of them on the net. However, it is in a lot of cases it is a lot better to actually create them yourselves. Depending on the site that you are attacking, you want to be able to customize them, you want to adapt them to your own needs. For example, let's say that there is a company somewhere, and that company has a profile on LinkedIn or something like that, and it has a list of its employees there, or you can at least find some of the employees that work for the company on LinkedIn there. So they would probably have something like standardized usernames for employee accounts. Basically, what that means is that you either have first name dot last name, or first name space last name, or first name just last name, nothing in between, something of a kind. So you can get those first names and last names, and you can generate a dictionary from there into a file. To generate a dictionary basically means just put the things that you want to try out into a file, and that's it. So just put the names, usernames, put the names in there, and that's not a really big deal. You can also use Crunch if you wish in order to generate them by default. It's not that difficult. It's pretty simple, straightforward procedure. Anyway, down below you have lowercase p for password, so you can pass in a single password and then try it against multiple usernames. Not a bad idea, but can be bad, but primarily because there's a low probability of success. But if you have managed to gather some information, if you know something more, usually people use brute force when they've acquired at least some bits and portions of information that you can really acquire realistically by just browsing the web. You can also pass a password file, you can pass a username file and a password file, and that's gonna use combinations from both. Anyway, down below there is a very neat option there's dash c, and then you specify a file. Where here, where it says file, you just specify the path to that file. Same thing goes for here and here. Here, instead of login, you would just type in a login name, and here, instead of a pass, you would just type in the password that you wish to try, as opposed to writing a path to a file here. Anyway, c dash c space file. It's a colon separated thing, so you can type in a login username, and right next to a username you can type in a password. It says here instead of dash l and dash b options. Now you might think, oh well, who's gonna make this tedious list or something like that, and sure, I can download it somewhere from the net, but why not just use them separately and see what I can get from there. Well, how about this? Now I have personally used this dash c for routers. Now, for example, a company, well, not really a company, a small firm, they had like different forms, different routers within their buildings. Some were for wireless, and those were of one brand, and they had their main gateway, default gateway, which was the exit to the outer world, which was of a completely different brand. And then they had their interior routers for just from the main gateway cable goes to this router, and then this router covers wirelessly this room, and so on and so forth. You get the idea. There was a whole spread. And then I used this dash c to basically test out the default usernames and passwords for all those routers, just to see if any of those routers actually contains a default username or a default username password combination. Now there aren't a lot of them, but different manufacturers, and I know you think, oh well, why do you need it? It's just admin, right? So you can just put in one entry. Well, no. Different manufacturers have different default credentials on their routers. Sure, a lot of the time, let's face it, it's just admin. But for some manufacturers, it can be UBNT for both username and password, I think. It can be root, and then for a password, it can be TOOR, just reverse of root. And you have these variations that you can find on the net. You can just type in default router passwords, and you can find all of them pretty much. So I just loaded up the list and attempted these. This saves you a lot of time. It doesn't raise that many. It can raise flags because default credentials have been attempted, but it doesn't raise any flags in a sense that you're not making too many attempts. I mean, you're making a couple of attempts per router, moving on, a couple of attempts, moving on and so forth. And with that, you can pretty much scan the entire network whether it contains default credentials. If any of them contains default credentials, you have immediately found one weakness that you can write in your report. So that's a bit of an easy test, which saves you a lot of time. Anyway, down below, you can use this in combination with dash c, and let me tell you something. Your home routers, usually get probed twice or thrice per a day by some IP address from God knows where, probing it for default credentials. Pretty much everyone's routers gets probed with this once. You can pass a file with a dash m option, which is a list of servers to attack, basically a list of IP addresses, and people from different parts of the world, they tend to pass these files, and they pass every single IP on the planet. They basically mass scan the internet. They use nmap to mass scan the internet, and then they load up live hosts with IP addresses to this file and what this file, and then pass this file to Hydra, which in turn attempts default login credentials, and if the default login credentials succeed, then they can be passed to different scripts that can do different things. So basically, you can alt people have been known to alter DNS settings on massive scales, because if you get maybe 1 million routers which have default credentials in their homes, and if you redirect all of their DNS requests to yourself, you can imagine the possibilities. I mean, you'll be able to do a lot. From redirecting all of their traffic to a certain site to basically exploiting them with some sort of basically zombifying them, making them bots or something of a kind. There are options are countless there. It would be even pointless to start listing them. But anyway, that's what people do generally. If you check out the log files, usually they'll get probed once or twice, maybe thrice per day. Anyway, the best way to protect this is simply to change the default user credentials, and as soon as the script sees that it's there, that the default ones are not used, who cares? It's just going to move on. Also, different telecoms in different countries use different default credentials for different router brands. These default credentials are always public. Most of the time they're public, and you can actually find them out on the net. So in a certain country, there are default credentials for that particular internet service provider that it uses on its router. So just before you conduct any sort of brute force attack, don't just go all out and try to hammer your way. I'd rather instead do a bit of research, do a bit of footprinting, try to figure out any additional information that can actually help you out. Anything is useful. Anything new that you learn is useful, and it can significantly lower the time of your brute force attack, and it can significantly reduce the possibility of a red flag. Down below, you have an option. It's T for tasks. Basically, this is the amount of threads that's going to run. Threads are processes which can run simultaneously or give an illusion of simultaneous operations. It says run tasks, number of connects in parallel. So per host default 16. So it's per one host, it's going to attempt 16 connections at the same at relatively the same time. The differences are trivial, like nanoseconds, so it doesn't really matter. Pretty sure it's nanoseconds, it could be some other measurement, but doesn't matter. The difference between the timer execution, between the execution of the threads. Anyway, you can specify a different amount of threads depending on what your processor can handle and depending on how obvious do you want this attack to be, because if you issue a lot of them, somebody on the other side is going to see that there are a lot of connections coming in at this pretty much the same time, so it's going to be obvious that there is something amiss. And you have dash u, we're going to skip that for now, dash help, it's a complete help, and okay, there are some other options down below, but for the time being, they're not that important. I would strongly advise you to check them out, as they also provide for different vectors of attack. For the time being, I want to show you how to attack a website login, and what I've told you now is specifically related to that purpose. Anyway, let's just go ahead and see how a Hydra command would look like. So you would just type in Hydra and then dash L either for users or dash L for a user. Actually, you have an example here, but look, this part is not difficult. So this you can do, this anybody can do, but that is not what we are here for to do. We need to get this part. This is for an FTP server, something we're not going to do today. You can see for FTP it's really simple. There isn't really that much logic to it. Rather instead we want to attack an HTTP website. Same procedure would apply for HTTPS if I'm not mistaken. It's going to work for HTTPS for sure. But I do believe that pretty much the same procedure applies. You just need to specify that it's HTTPS. Anyway, what we need is these field names. So we need a field name of username and we need a field name of password. So what we need to do is right-click on the website, inspect element. Sorry, no, not inspect element. View page source. View selection. Come on, don't do this to me. View selection source, excellent. Or most of the time you're going to see view page source. So you will need to be able to find username fields and password fields in order to actually do this, and you will also need the login submit button. Anyway, you can also do this with Burp Suite. I've showed you this in the previous tutorial on the SQL injections where we've actually extracted a cookie. Using exactly the same procedure, you can also get these things as well, but in this tutorial I wanted to show a bit of a different method, perhaps a bit easier method to actually figure these things out. But it's pretty easy here on the Damn Vulnerable app, primarily because you can get these individual sections and take a look at them like this. But if we, for example, open up any other website like Kali Docs. Oh, wait, and let's see. View page source. You can see how a page source will look like. It's clumsy, it's long. I'm not saying that this code is clumsy, but it might appear like that, and it's pretty long, so yeah, it's gonna take a while for, I mean, you're gonna find it eventually, but it might take a while to actually figure out where is what. I would suggest using a control F option and type in just user. Okay, it doesn't, this particular website doesn't have a login form if I'm correct. Yep, it doesn't actually have a login form, but it doesn't matter. You just type in username and control F or something of a kind, and then just sweep through the source of the website in order to find whatever it is that you are looking for. In this particular case, we are looking for the username and password forms. So go ahead and right-click view page source, and in our case, view section source, because this allows you to see actually different sections separately. It's a lot easier that way. What we will need here is name, which will be username, and password for name for the field, it's password. We will need these two. We will need the portion of the address, and we will also need the IP address of the server, which is if config. Excellent. So this is the IP address of our server. How to find the IP address of that particular server, I've showed that in the previous tutorials. So those are the things that we're going to need in the follow-up tutorial where we will actually conduct a brute forcing attack. I did take this time to actually explain all the options because Hydra, it can be complicated from time to time, especially with this last section. Pass the username and pass the password. You need to pass in additional parameters, which can get a little bit tricky. You will see soon why. Anyway, I bid you all farewell, and I hope to see you in the follow-up tutorial.